The great Russian pianist Vladimir Ashkenazy said that Rachmaninoff tried to express something essential in our lives in his music. Basic human fears. The fear of death, the fear of falling into darkness. These are essential feelings that Rachmaninoff expressed in his variations. The music begins with a powerful theme based on the chord progression, and the evolving characters are like the metamorphosis of our natural world. And so tonight we have chosen this music to convey our variations on a theme of extinction. We want you to know that we are not partitioning this incredibly expressive piece of music lightly. We are harnessing a formidable piece of music to address a formidable global issue.
Since 1970, 40% of everything that has the breath of life, animals and plants, has been erased from the face of the earth. 4 out of every 10 beings. The number of vertebrate animals has been cut in half. The beasts of the earth, the birds of the air, the fishes of the seas, amphibians, reptiles. Of these, freshwater fish, frogs, and shorebirds had it the worst. Do you remember 1970? It was the year when John Lennon announced that the Beatles were through, and Apollo 13 made that terrifying return to Earth from the moon. If you remember, then you were alive when there were almost twice as many plants and animals, forests and fields as there are now. And if you don't remember 1970, you have spent your whole life in a world that has been recently stripped by almost half. Impoverished, simplified, drained, and bulldozed world. I will die in a world that is half as abundantly beautiful as the one I was born into. My children will tear out half the pages in their field guides and throw them away. My grandchildren's picture books about singing hippopotami, dancing penguins, and wise old owls will be fantasies. It's our generation that is witnessing the end of the era that we evolved in, Thomas Berry wrote. My generation has done what no previous generation could do because they lacked the technological power, and what no future generation will be able to do because the planet will never again be so beautiful or abundant. Thank you. In the beginning, there was a yellow glow pouring onto the purple skin of the sea. Rising and sinking in the glare, the seas mixed with the dry land and spilled into the bays. In the shining slick, the earth brought forth the first life. Creation worked like music. Life began with a simple basic theme and repeated it now again, replicated it now again, complicated it now, connected it again into the lyric chords of all creation. DNA and the musical structure of the theme and variations display the same powerful, complexifying beauty. At first, there were sponge-like things, medusas and polyps, gelatinous themes and all their variations. And then, 100,000 years ago, came the evolution of human consciousness. The theme of life reorganized itself to stand on two legs, turn to the sky, and contemplate its own beginning and its end. We are, Mary Evelyn Tucker says, beings in whom the universe shivers in wonder at itself. Wonder. Yeah, wonder at the extraordinary chance that we find ourselves in the Cenozoic era, when evolution has achieved its greatest fullness of flowering, what the theologian Thomas Berry called the most lyric period in Earth history. Imagine our good fortune to live in the time of thrush song and 30,000 species of orchids, the time of microscopic sea angels with tiny wings and whales that teach each other to sing, the time of crocodiles and butterflies with curled tongues and a bat no bigger than a bee. The planet is still crammed with lives of urgent thriving, crawling all over each other, burrowing into every crack. The fate of these lives is not a matter of indifference or of economic expediency. These lives are the irreplaceable consequence of planetary creativity over 4 billion years. Last year, under gathering clouds, I knelt beside a tide pool. Maybe you have done the same. Blue mussels paved the rocks, cutting my hand when I turned a stone. The bottom of the stone was slathered with life. Tiny starfish, algae like orange paint, crust of bread sponges, porcelain crabs disguised as pebbles, decorator crabs disguised as seaweed, fish disguised as rays of light. The moving tide was noisy, the harsh inhale and groan. Scritching claws and bubbling jaws, a constant plop, plop, as seawater dripped off globules and tentacles and who knows what. Behind me, I could hear my small grandsons calling to each other, "Guys, come, look and see." And then out in the inlet, a humpbacked whale began to roar. The music of this place, it's wonderful. Never have I heard as complete a repudiation of the idea that human beings are better somehow, that we're in charge, that we're the point of the whole thing. Each being is worthy. Each fractal layer is necessary. All the lives, the theme. All the lives, the variations. And there in the tide pool, there were sunflower sea stars, gooey and heavy, sometimes a meter across, stubbled with spines like the gray chin of an ancient man. They creep after prey on legs with 100,000 tube feet. And when they're stressed, their legs fall off and crawl away, shedding a chemical that warns of danger. How shimmering with menace the very seawater must be on the day this creature dies. All the years, we humans have been lifted by the assurance that birds would go and birds would return, that storms would come in season and storms would blow back to sea again, that fish would scatter eggs before they died. The music of the world was a repeating promise, a promise that harmony would be restored again and again in chords so complicated and beautiful that we could love them, even if we couldn't fully understand the genius of their pattern. In Washington, the first rufous hummingbirds returned in late February when the blueberries rebloomed at the coast. Violet-green swallows returned to their ponds in early March to meet the mayflies. It was a great day in the swamps in early April when American bitterns and yellow-headed blackbirds swooped in, grumping and hollering. The humans and the birds slept and woke by this, lived and died in this faith in inevitable unfolding harmony. The expectation and the arrival, the call and the response, the question and the answer, the world's promise of absolution and return. The weather comes now and goes, and who can make sense of it? Last year, drought dried the grass fields where insects and mice would have grown abundant, and the peregrine falcons, skinny or starved, produced no young. Last year, the swallows came back before winter was finished, and there were no insects in the wind. Have you seen a starved swallow, its wing frozen to the sand? Have you seen the frozen eye of a swallow? It's white. You can't see into it. Five times in planetary history, life has faced catastrophic extinction. Awful forces of exploding rocks, boiling seas, poisonous clouds, or icy glaciation and shrinking seas, or storms of comets ended forever the possibilities in the strange and wonderful bodies. Five massive extinctions when evolutionary development started over with what was left. And now we're told we live in the time of the sixth great extinction, bringing the Cenozoic era to a close. How astonishing to find ourselves in this time. Extinction. Extinguish. cause to cease burning all those sparking lives. We all know the story scientists tell about the last great extinction. We've seen the movie. A pterosaur wings out of a giant tree fern. Maybe he feels in the quivering trees the impact of an asteroid on the other side of the Earth and flies off, startled by something he has never felt before. It's the end of the Cretaceous, 66 million years ago, when perhaps 80% of the species vanished, most dinosaurs and many of the small creatures of the seas. Is it possible? Is it possible that we are living through an extinction event of equal power? In the last 40 years, 39% of terrestrial wildlife gone. 39% of marine wildlife gone. 76% of freshwater wildlife gone in our lifetimes. The greatest extinctions are in the poor countries, with losses of 58%, where the wealthy countries are outsourcing their environmental destruction. What's the cause? That's not hard to know. Just lift your eyes to these very hills, or glance across the valleys, or walk into Walmart. Deforestation, a dramatic loss of habitat, overharvesting of the oceans, poisoning of land and air, agricultural expansion, and global warming. And what causes that? A way of life, a constantly growing, all-consuming culture driven by extractive industries that have few moral or legal constraints. For heaven's sake, people tell me, change happens. Animals come and go. Evolution is a game with winners and losers. If it weren't for the dinosaur extinctions, there wouldn't be human beings. Hurrah for the fifth extinction. All true. But there's a distinction between change and destruction, and that's the difference between death and murder. For all their horror, the early extinctions were natural earth processes, acts of God. This current great wave of dying is a direct result of human decisions, knowing and intentional or wantonly reckless. That changes a calamity into a cosmic crime, a failure of our responsibilities toward the lives that are now in our hands. Extinctions 1-5 call us to awe. Extinction 6 calls us to rage, rage against the dying. It's madness, the trades we make. Unless something stops us, we'll keep on converting living creatures into dead commodities. We trade deep mossy forests for uselessly large homes. We trade wide-winged albatrosses for plastic six-pack rings. We trade a meadow miraculous with butterflies for an industrial park to manufacture My Little Ponies. Dear God, the madness. We trade a singing marsh for another Kmart parking lot. It's madness, this consumption, this eating up. We trade rhinoceros horn for male sexual potency. We trade bear spleens for sexual potency. We trade Tibetan red deer for sexual potency. What is this overriding need? We trade fence rows and goose sloughs for yet more golf course grass seed. We trade an oak thicket for housing no one wants. We trade spotted owls for typing paper. We trade old oaks for turning lanes. What are we thinking? For corn to burn in our cars, we're happy to give up monarch butterflies. For one more fitness center, we blithely give up the spring chorus of frogs. For oil terminals, we give away the salmon. Do we care more about oil terminals than we care about salmon? It's a frenzied, mad auction of what is of ancient value for what is cheap and desperately sad. It's a mad rush to the end of the world. The most terrible trade is the transmogrification of plants and animals into human flesh. Daniel Quinn says since 1970, that same 1970, the biomass of the human species has gained 50 million tons. It came from other members of the community of life. As a result, the world is losing 150 species a day. We are turning 150 species a day into human fat and gristle. And no one should assume that the human species can come out ahead on this. We're like people who live in a penthouse of a 100-story building. Every day we send workers down to remove blocks from the foundation so we can make our penthouse fancier, bigger. This might work for 100 days, but for hundreds of years? At some point, we will have created so many channels of emptiness that the entire structure will collapse. Ever since I read this penthouse analogy, I've been haunted by a nightmare imagining of my grandchildren's future children, Theo's babies, Zoe's babies. With their arms spread, they're falling from a high penthouse, crying out like broken sparrows. Thank you. to ask, what do we stand to lose? An Amur leopard or a gut-shot black rhinoceros falling to its knees, the hawksbill turtle, the chimpanzee, a mountain gorilla shot from the jungle trees falling through an explosion of red parrots and a rain of green leaves. Yangtze sturgeon, Chinese sturgeon, Persian sturgeon, Atlantic sturgeon settling into the mud. Snake River sockeye caught by its shining gill plates in a ghost net, dying in a falling rain of fish scales. Snow leopard, its curled body frozen under falling snow. Marine iguana, staghorn coral dying in the warming sea. Condors and kit foxes chased from the cliffs by fracking pumps loud as diesel trucks. Black-footed ferrets startled from their burrows by the rhythmic thud of seismic oil explorations. The blue whale, the narwhal, hazed by underwater seismic oil explorations, air guns exploding every 10 seconds. The thud, the pain of impact on the ears, every 10 seconds, the thud. The industrial growth economy has offered us a terrible bribe, Lewis Mumford said. These are the terms. We can have anything we want. Bouquets of Ecuadorian roses, elegant meals of seared tuna and pineapple, huge houses and room-sized cars, every pleasure and comfort sailing on through the sunlit days. Closets full of clothes, kitchens shining with the most amazing slice and dice machines, garages gleaming with new cars, music on demand, movies on demand, everything we want on demand. Giant Airbuses, guaranteed free two-day delivery of anything in the world, this glory, this tailgate bratwurst. On the condition that we never ask where it came from or at what cost. At what cost to the planet, and at what cost in human and animal suffering. At what cost to the future, and to what long-term effect. As long as we never look back and see the ruined forest and the souring oceans, the deaths that are required to produce these pleasures. As long as we never look forward and foresee the ecosystem collapse, the dead zones, the danger. That's the deal. If you ask the cost, the glittering life becomes impossible. The extractive, all-consuming economy reveals itself as a giant going out of business sale. Planetary and moral bankruptcy. The economy of dying. How can this be right? David Foreman answers. He says, our asking should begin on the bedrock that we, of course, have an obligation to wild things of all species, today and tomorrow, to honor their intrinsic value, and thus to act only in ways that keep whole the beauty, integrity, and stability of the earth. Those who want out of that obligation will have to fully show how it's okay to snuff life for short-term selfish ends. This shifts the burden of proof in a strong and mindful way. Those who would shatter life will have to show in a deep, wide way why this careless, carefree, uncaring behavior is good. That will be hard, so hard to do. What if it were aliens that were invading the planet and causing this extinction? Derek Jensen asks us to imagine this. Imagine that it's not the industrial growth economy after all. It's not the fossil fuel corporations. Here the aliens are, green and nasty, flipper-footed, swarming Earth, infiltrating everything. They set about to sicken children with asthma, poison the groundwater, stir the storms into devastating forces, pour oil over the shrimp beds. They inject poisonous wastes into caves until the earth trembles. Summoning hurricanes, they drown old women in their attics. They pump acid into the oceans. They blast cropland into deserts. They inundate estuaries. They skim topsoil into the rivers, choke them with nitrogen. They skin the mountain forest using giant machines that cut trees off at the knees and carry them away. They kill off the plants and animals on this planet, half the plants and animals so far. What would we say? That is morally monstrous. What would we do? The whole world would mobilize to stop them in their green, flippered tracks. So we find ourselves at an intermezzo, when even the music extemporizes, wildly searching for a way forward. And so are we at this hinge point in history, desperately searching for a way forward. Even if it breaks our heart, even if it changes our lives forever, we have to confront the essential question: what do we love too much to lose? In the spring, when our granddaughter was born, I brought her to the pond so she could feel the comfort I had known there for so many years. Killdeer waddled in mud by the shore, but not so many as before. Ahead of the coming heat, butterflies fed in the mud between the cracks, unrolling their tongues to touch salty soil. I held my granddaughter in my arms and sang to her then, an old lullaby that made her soften like wax in a flame, molding her little body to my bones. She fell asleep in my arms, unafraid. I will tell you, I was so afraid. Poets warned us, writing of the heartbreaking beauty that will remain when there is no heart to break for it. But what if it's worse than that? What if it's the heartbroken children who remain in a world without beauty? How will they find solace in a world without wild music? How will they thrive without green hills edged with oaks? How will they forgive us for letting frog song slip away? It isn't enough to love a child and wish her well. It isn't enough to open my heart to a bird-graced morning. Can I claim to love a morning if I don't protect what creates its beauty? Can I claim to love a child if I don't use all the power of my beating heart to preserve a world that nourishes children's joy? Loving is not a kind of la-di-da. Loving is a sacred trust. To love is to affirm the absolute worth of what you love and to pledge your life to its thriving, to protect it fiercely and faithfully for all time. Ring the angelus for the salmon and the swallows. Ring the bells for frogs floating in bent reeds. Ring the bells for all of us who did not save the songs. Mother of God, ring the bells for every sacred emptiness. Let them echo in the silence at the end of the day. Forgiveness is too much to ask. I would pray for only this, that our granddaughter would hear again the little lick of music, that gray snort toward the ends of a meadowlark's song. Meadowlarks. There were meadowlarks. They sang like angels in the morning. What does it matter? Why is it important that there be this planet with these odd little creatures? It could all end tomorrow, so what? Why would we care? We wouldn't know. Would anything of value be lost? The answer, of course, is yes. It matters that 100 years from now, salmon are returning to the streams. Children are kneeling to watch glowworms in the grass. Red-legged frogs are burbling underwater. We're struggling to talk about something of deep sacredness, as Mary Catherine Bates says. The creativity of this living world is continuing to unfold, and that unfolding is sacred. Be prepared to wonder at this unfurling. Be prepared also for this, that every extinction, every suffering, every destruction is a diminishment of creativity, and so it is a profanity. Be prepared for anger and for grief. The world is a mystery of infinite and intrinsic value. Be prepared to love it in ways beyond our own understanding. This wondering love is what brings us to the work ahead of us and sustains us in the struggle. This is the wonder-filled world that we're destroying, the lyric voices that we're silencing, the sanctity that we're defiling, at a rate and with a violence that cannot be measured because we have only the sorriest understanding of the world's multitude of lives. So what do we have to do? 3 things. And we have to do them all. It's true that thousands of species are irretrievably gone. It's true that the greenhouse gas pollution already in the atmosphere is going to cause climate changes that will work themselves out over millennia. It's true that all we have to do to leave a ruined world for our children, as Gus Best says, is to continue to do what we're already doing. It's true that what we are doing to the world is wrong beyond words. Given that, we have to do the one thing we can do. We have to stop making it worse. Which means that we have to stop releasing greenhouse gases. We have to leave the Earth's ancient carbon in the ground. We have to stop bulldozing forests into burn piles. We have to stop paving meadows, for God's sake. We've got to stop buying stuff and eating ourselves sick. So this is the question each of us asks individually and collectively. What destruction can I stop? What oil terminal? What parking lot? What GMO crop? What coal train? What poison spraying truck? What clear cut? What pipeline? Choose one. Move fast. Bring art, bring crowds, bring pressure, bring lawsuits, bring the children's choir, bring the church choir singing Bach. Hold your leaders to account. If they sell out to the culture of destruction, throw them out. If they stand courageously against it, stand with them. Not another mountaintop, not another rainforest, not another estuary, not another prairie. Not another mighty river can be traded away for cash. These are not industries to take or sell. They belong to the future of the everlasting earth. Step two, we protect, restore, grow, preserve, we hold on to what we've still got. Noah knew that whatever survived the great flood would repopulate the world, the lions and the elephants two by two. Now, millennia later, the world is going through a biological bottleneck as brutal as God's fury in Noah's time. Whatever species make it through, that's what the world will be made of. Noah protested, "I'm old, I'm tired. Why me, O Lord?" The answer is, it's got to be everybody. Each asking, what ark can I build? What habitat can I save or create that will carry living things? It comes to me that every good act might be an ark, no matter how small, the Portland author David Oates wrote to me. Every good act might be a widening arc of consequence, incalculable. There will be flotillas of arcs. There will be handmade ones and massive ones, science arcs like battleships and garden arcs like rowboats, all set into the forward river of time to sail, if possible, through the narrow part of the hourglass of our era. There will be arcs for fungi, arcs for metafauna, grandstand wilderness arcs with million-dollar funding, and anonymous arcs, memorials of lost passion. Arcs like Moses adrift in the bulrushes. Arcs like coracles of Irish monks ferrying their manuscripts to safe places. Seeds and flowers, babies and youngsters, spores and flagellates, dirt clods, lumps indistinguishable. And then what? To touch chance-wise on dry land and start the world anew. Yes, I say to David, well said. We have to do everything we can to stop the flood, or at least to lessen it, to keep it from washing over the mountaintops. That's the first thing and the most important. And then we have to save what we can, fishing it out of the sloshing waves and bringing it to safety. The third and necessary thing, start over. Our problem isn't with renewable energy or farmed fish or other increasingly desperate means to save our way of life. The problem is our way of life itself, a culture that prides itself on accumulating wealth instead of sharing it, a culture that gobbles up the fecundity of the planet instead of nurturing it, an economy that eats its own children. Any economy of infinite extraction will kill off the sources of its sustenance. Our work is not to find ways to save this way of life. The challenge is to save the sustaining world from this way of life's destructive power. And so the challenge is to invent life ways of respect and restraint that work with rather than against the living, thriving earth. Music is a precarious relationship of sounds moving through time, ephemeral, forever changing. That's what a healthy ecosystem is too. That's what a life is. It may be true that everything beautiful flies apart sometime or another, but music sometimes holds it together. That's the miracle in music. Meadows sometimes hold it together. That's the miracle of meadows with all the beings in their skittering, soaring places. And aren't people trying to hold it together, each in our own way? Dear God, aren't we trying? I believe that everything awaits redemption at every moment. Redemption. When the pieces, which are scattered, are brought together again into the vibrant interconnectedness of living systems, we yearn to be called back in. Everything yearns to be called back into a right relationship, the frogs into their chorus, the cicadas into their pulsing choir, the people into Earth's harmonies, the dancing insects into their light. The cosmic challenge of our time is to recreate our humanity through this great crisis. And this means not just saving our species, but realizing our full humanity as it evolves in kinship with all the world's blooming, bellowing lives, so that we can learn what it means to live in concert with the earth. On the reeling planet that we hold in our hands, may gentle rain fall forever on green fields. May ice always return to glaze the bays. May rice endlessly grow where killdeer call. May salmon forever slide up river and lilies unfurl beside the snow. May frogs lay eggs in lavender orchids and bat wings whisper forever in dripping caves. May children hum themselves to sleep in the safe and sustaining night.